Hey guys, what's happening? Alright, is that too loud? Alright, cool. Thank you, coming back for day two. Very excited to see you. Thank you a lot for your contribution yesterday and also hanging out, having some drinks and bidding on our awesome items. So, any housekeeping, anything before we get rolling? Everybody's here, everybody's excited? Nice, awesome.
I'm just curious if there's any stories from last night.
Anything weird happened?
Anything we shouldn't talk about?
Nothing?
Played the fifth.
Oh, did you guys go all the way out?
I think they tore up.
Even better. Well, then we are excited to introduce my man, AA, Aaron Ausmus. I connected with AA on our podcast, and it was one of those relationships that when you get on the podcast, you start talking, you think to yourself, shit, how come I haven't known this dude longer? I felt like, we could have been friends for the last decade. Ironically, he lives not far from where I grew up, about 2 or 3 miles, and actually trains at the gym, which is called The Yard, and the guy that owns it, a guy, Troll, actually, I used to train there in high school. And when he bought that gym, I helped him move equipment into that gym. So as we're talking, he's like, oh, I train in The Yard in Hermosa Beach with Troll. And I was like, oh my God, I met that dude when I was 13 years old. Ironically, I was still 4 inches taller than Troll because he's about 5'6".
No.
He's not 5'6"? Was he 5'4"? 5'2". It's tough on a dude to be 5'2". It's tough on a woman to be 5'2", as you know, Paula. But it's a little bit harder for a dude. It was great to connect. Really an illustrious career, accomplished thrower, and I'm not going to get into your accolades, I'll let you do that. Went on Tennessee, USC, strength coach, and was pretty much steeped in that community, and then decided that he wanted to stay here in Southern California with his kids and started working for Sornex. And then that's how we made our good relationship with Bert and Sornex, and also Ed Cosner there in the back. So without further ado, AA Aaron Ausmus. Thank you.
How are we doing?
Good.
Good. Well, I feel honored because if you had a big night and you're here for the first lecture, it must mean you want to hear something. So I hope I can deliver here. I want to talk about coaching and bring something that I feel that hopefully you can take from this talk. And I'm guessing many of you are coaches, and a coach can be kind of anyone that helps someone. Personal trainer, you maybe run groups, maybe you're a high school strength coach, college strength coach, maybe you're a gym owner, whatever it might be. But I didn't come to talk about a horse carriage coach, okay, or flying coach on an airplane. Okay, I came to talk about motivating and influencing other people. So if you look at the definition of a coach, it says to give instruction or advice. That's the definition of coaching. So synonym is a mentor. And I feel everyone in this audience falls into this category of some form. If you look at, again, my experience, John went over it a little bit. Like I said, I've been on the podcast, so I'm going to save you about 30 minutes of this lecture if you ever want to go back and go through that. But again, I was a shot putter. I was a walk-on at Tennessee. Became an NCAA champion 4 years later. I felt I became an NCAA champion from strength conditioning, which put me into strength conditioning. My strength coach had so much influence on me that it pretty much propelled me into the profession. Did 16 years. Most of it was a head strength coach. I've been all over this country doing it. I've been at, I'll go through this really quick, GA at Tennessee, assistant at USC, head strength coach at Idaho, head strength coach at Ole Miss, head strength coach at North Texas, head strength coach at Tennessee, and a head strength coach at USC. So a lot of cross-country trips, a lot of back and forth, a lot of chasing that dream, chasing that next job, chasing that next title, chasing that next salary, chasing that next contract, okay? I've been there, and it was awesome, and I'd do it again. Started lifting weights when I was about 15, so that kind of tells you my age. I just turned 42 a couple weeks ago. Been lifting for 27 years. Coaches, okay, anybody that mentor coaches, okay, a good friend of mine threw this out there and I loved it because he just sent this to me by text. And he said, what is a coach? Someone that has a leadership of a general, vision of a CEO, okay, knowledge of a professor, motivating like a drill instructor, tracking of an accountant, and commitment of a teacher. This guy's the head strength coach at Wisconsin-Milwaukee. Worked with him while I was at Ole Miss. So it's great for me to stay in contact with these people that I work with because they're always, again, we're kind of feeding each other nuggets. I didn't know when I got into coaching about all this part of it. Okay? I got into coaching because I love lifting weights and I love getting people strong. So learning to be good at these things, these traits, is something you have to start putting time in, putting experiences in, and actually learning how to be good in this part. And a lot of people can build a beautiful Excel sheet, okay, but can't coach a lick, okay? They can build a great program, it's all beautiful on Excel, it's all formatted, okay, but they can't go out there and coach it and motivate it and make it work. So this part of coaching, all right, for me, it was huge to learn, and it took me a little later in my career to really start realizing this. Coming out of the barrel hot, okay? I don't know if you've ever heard that term. That's when someone's a fast starter, okay? You get in a fire, you're, whatever it is, you come out swinging, okay? You're not trying to make it a marathon. You come out as fast as you can, coming out of the gate fast. Well, that was kind of my career. Okay, and I kind of think back to that song in the 1980s. I don't know if you remember that song, One Thing Leads to Another. Well, I started lifting weights, which got me into throwing, which got me to this first ring at Tennessee. Okay, so I was an NCAA champion, which got me leading into strength conditioning, which got me into this second and the third ring. So while I was a GA, we won the SEC championship, and we won the national championship in 98. And I was a grad assistant. I thought shit just happened like that, okay? I just thought, wow, this is, you start coaching, you win championships. Well, I worked for a guy that was older, very, very, very polished. He was in his 50s. He sat down with us in the staff room, and he said, guys, do you know how special this is? We just won a national championship. Me and the young guys were back there just snickering. Like, yeah, that's what you do. He's like, I've been coaching 20-something years, and this is my first one. This is special, okay? So, again, I didn't understand that yet. Well, those championships at Tennessee led me to first job, assistant at USC. Not a bad place. Okay, I grew up in Tennessee, so I moved to Southern California for the first time back in 2001. Well, it took about 2 years, joining with Pete Carroll. We won a championship, okay? 2 years later, in 2003, we won a championship, and we played Michigan in the Rose Bowl and won a championship. So my first, I don't know, 5 or 6 years in the profession was just hot. It was fast, and we won. And I just thought, this is how it's gonna go from now on. So I had to learn, and you have to get humble. Well, what you have to learn is what goes up comes down, okay? What goes up comes down. So again, these are some of the things I wrote about. Strength coaches are inspiring, they're hardworking, they're glue for team chemistry. Again, there's an educator word. You become a teacher, you're a tough, you're a leader, okay? Strength coaches are not, okay? This is what I learned, are not bulletproof, okay? And I didn't learn that till I got my ass fired when I was at Ole Miss. We went there, we didn't win enough games. 3 years later, we're all packing our offices. I didn't know what to do, okay? First time happened to me. I'm thinking, but my rings. Look at all my fucking rings. You can't do this to me. I came out the barrel hot, okay? Humbling experience right here. What do? I set out 2008 and had to figure out maybe what can I do to become a better coach. went through tough times. You're about to run out of money. Okay? What do? So I learned real quick when I went on my first job interview, and I really didn't go prepared because here it was. I'm thinking about those rings again. They're going to hire me. I've got 5 rings. I've got championships. I've worked at USC. We won a championship at Tennessee. It's going to get me the job. Well, I went in unprepared, and I didn't get it. Devastated. What's going on? Well, when I went in for that job interview, I didn't have any substance about myself. All I could rely on was those rings, those championships. And I thought that's going to be good enough to get me to my next job. So, learned real quick that I need to reevaluate myself. And how do I do that? So the first thing I learned is I need to claim my victory. And I learned this from Pete Carroll. And it's really neat to think about. When you go in with your mission statement and you build your philosophy as a coach, you got to say, well, what is going to make us successful? What is success in our department as a strength coach? And I learned again from Pete Carroll was you have to put in there what you can control. So I felt I want to have a united staff my next job, whenever it is, okay? And I just want to develop winners. That's it. Winners on the field, winners on the court, winners in life, winners as people. That's my next thing. Develop winners and have a united staff. Well, what I learned from Pete Carroll was when he took over at SC in those years, he didn't go to his first team meeting and goes, guys, we're going to go undefeated and we're going to win the national championship. He said, because you're kind of setting yourself up. What if you lose the second game? Your mission statement just went to shit, right? But you could still win the rest of the year and have a successful season. So what he said was really, really smart when I think about it now. He used to say, guys, we want to win our conference and play in the Rose Bowl. That's our goal as a program every year. Win the Pac, back then it was the Pac-10, now it's the Pac-12. Win the Pac-10 and go to the Rose Bowl. And he said, but if we're so good that they vote us into that big game, that's back when it was the BCS championship, we'll go play and kick their ass too. But he put themselves in a controllable. Because you can lose a game but still win your conference. You win your conference, you go to the Rose Bowl automatically. Because you're the Pac-12 or the Pac-10 champion. So that's something I really learned from Pete Carroll is you got to claim your victory and make it attainable. Think about this. Western Michigan just won the championship. I think they just finished 13-0. Okay? Just think of that coach when he took the job 3 or 4 years ago and says, guys, our goal is to go undefeated and play in the national championship. Well, they just went undefeated. They just won their conference. They're 13-0. They're not going to play in the national championship. You just let them down. So make your goal attainable within what you want to do. Here's some examples of being united. And I learned this through coaching. Okay, united we stand, divided we fall. You've probably heard that before. Okay, it only takes one person who sends a mixed message, okay, to your athletes. And when that happens, you've got bad business in your program right there. So for example, if you guys teach in your program the high bar squat, and you got 5 people teaching high bar squat, but you got this asshole, okay, when you ain't looking, saying, hey man, you guys should really try the low bar squat. I do it myself, and it's better, okay? You got bad business. That's not a united staff, okay? Things will start happening within your program because of that bad business, that one person, okay? Your verbiage of how you talk in your program is huge. I was a big believer in saying training. We're going to strength train tomorrow. We're not going to work out. When you work out, you do what you want to do. When you train, you do what you need to do. So as a staff, we made a thing. We never say workout. We see our player. Hey, what time are you strength training tomorrow? It's a different mindset. I said it right here. Well, look at the alarm, 5:30 a.m., strength training.
When you wake up and say, I got to go get this workout, or I get to go do my strength training, it's a different mindset. So we wanted to set the seed, plant the seed as a staff on just what we identify our room with. Know your product, okay? Right here, my program's like an old country store that sells milk, pop, and bread. I utilize this press, squat, and dead. What is your product? If you feel you're gonna get lower body strength through squatting and front squatting, and you're gonna get explosive strength through power cleans and throwing med balls, and you're gonna get upper body strength through bench pressing and pull-ups, that's your product, okay? You and your staff better know what you're selling. If so, it'll become effective. That's being united. That's believing in your product, and your athletes will start, guess what? Believing in what you're selling to them. Again, this is my financial advisor. He gave me this analogy. But the squat may not be the hot stock, like the heart rate monitor, because it's more like Clorox bleach, okay? It's boring company, but solid. But it makes money year in, year out. So if you're selling, guys, we want to be great at squatting, we're going to get strong from squatting, okay? That's what you should always keep believing in. You can't teeter-totter around, and if you have a loss or something, you don't get that PR, you go, you know what, we're going to throw squatting out, we're going to go back, we're going to start leg pressing now. You can't go back and forth. You got to figure out your product, and you got to believe in it. If so, okay, you'll get the feedback. This is such a two-way street. A strength staff wants buy-in. All you want, everybody you work with, I promise you, you want them to believe in you. You want them to buy into you. You want them to buy into your template, buy into your style. Well, the athletes or the people you work with, they want a unified message from you guys, from us. That's why being united, being on the same page is so big. And then on the right here, I use this as an analogy. Here's a daily plan. It's got speed, it's got plyos, it's got agility, it's got core, it's got strength, it's got nutrition, it's got the recording part where you're changing maxes, it's got conditioning. Okay, it can be a great plan. But if you don't have the people in the process, it's broken. If your staff's not united, okay, your process is broken. So that's why it's so important. First thing I think anybody wants is for the people you work to have faith in you. You want your athletes, the people you work with, to have faith in you. So the best thing you can do is have faith in what you're giving to them. Again, going back to the unified message. So, again, I'm not going to try to pick on people here, but you work with athletes. Why do they have faith in you?
Because they've had results, or have you seen other people that have good results?
Perfect. Why do your athletes you work with have faith in you?
Because I'm there.
All right. Every day? So for me, we as a staff, we talked about, this is my first pillar of a coaching philosophy when I developed this, and I'll put it all together at the end. The first one to me is faith, okay? And I want to give my athletes, again, I'm going to put what all you guys said. They know I'm going to be there, okay? My athletes always knew we're going to come in and we're going to start on time. They knew we're going to do Olympic lifts. They knew we're going to do squatting. They knew we're going to do conditioning. That's hard. They knew we're going to have energy in the weight room. Okay? They knew that because as a staff, we came in and expected that every day, and they saw us to do that. So it's a two-way street. I wanted them to buy in, okay? But before that, they had to have faith in what we're selling them. Okay? So this is where it starts. When I think of faith, I think of just totally trusting in someone. Whatever they say, I'm going to do it. So I can't give you a better example
was when I was an athlete, I was a shot putter, 1997. I'd had the best fall of my career. I was throwing great. I was PRing every week. We were in the indoor season. And it came time for the big show. The big show is the NCAA championship. It's always the first week of March. It was at the RCA Dome back then at Indianapolis. Well, I threw on Friday night, and I had a back squat max of about 616, 280 kilos at the time. Well, it's a Tuesday, and I'm throwing Friday night in Indianapolis, and I'm in Tennessee. So we have a back squat day. And I looked to my coach, and I never had a sheet. He had the sheet. You know what I'm saying? And I just always looked at him, what's next? What's next? You know, and just he'd tell me what weight, we'd add the weight, you know. And I didn't know where the plan was going to go, but I knew I was going to follow the plan. So we're rolling, we're squatting, and the plates keep adding, And next thing you know, there's getting a little crowd around the room. And we added up, and I was around 600 pounds. Well, what happened was the other assistants in the weight room started freaking out, because they knew I had the biggest meet of my life in 3 days. And they're looking to him like, what the fuck you doing? This guy's got the biggest meet of his life, and you're pretty much hitting around 100% of his max on a Tuesday. He's throwing on a Friday night. And he's just like, relax, relax, relax. So I hit 600 pounds. Again, adrenaline was rolling. Go to Friday. We travel on Thursday, drive up, throw a PR on Friday night, and win the NCAA championship. So when I got back, no one was questioning him, okay? No one was questioning him. But for me, I didn't even blink an eye. Again, I was, tell me what to do, and we'll do it. And that's the faith. When I started coaching and I started building this philosophy, that's the faith I wanted my athletes to have in me, where they just look to me, and whatever is done, they just go. They don't even think about it. They don't need to be told, well, why are we going to do this? Why are we going light today? Why are we going heavy today? Do you know I'm sore from yesterday? We just went, and that's what I wanted. And when I started thinking about building a pillar of faith. Okay, the next one is passion. Huge word, thrown around everywhere. Everybody talks about passion, gotta have passion. Okay, it's to love something, obviously. You see kids when they're playing, they go out and they just go out there on the basketball court. Next thing you know, 5 hours later, they haven't eaten, they haven't drinking water, they've been playing the whole time. They're just passionate about playing basketball because they love it, okay? Rob McKeefer, I took this, he was a Summer Strong. He's like, spell love, and then I'm like, he's like, T-I-M-E, what you spend time on is what you're passionate about. Again, two-way street pillar here. When I designed this philosophy, I thought, to get it, you gotta give it. Coaches desire athletes to enter the weight room and train with passion. Athletes desire their coaches to enter the weight room and coach them with passion. Passion to love. I used to always invite coaches to come watch us train wherever I was at. A lot of high school coaches, outsiders, would email, can we come watch your program? And they would watch, and they would stand there, they'd take notes, and you know, the music's playing, or we're cleaning, we're squatting. Every time they would say, can I have some words with you in your office? Sure, I've got questions. Okay, come in. They're like, how do you get energy in the weight room? Your players, they lift with so much energy. Like, I've never seen that. And your staff, they're on fire. Why do they coach so hard? I've never seen it. I don't get it, why? My players come in and it's like, you know, browbeating them to move, to get them to go to the rack. And my answer was always, you gotta go look in the mirror. If you don't come in and coach with passion, demand it out of your staff, your athletes aren't gonna give it either. So again, it goes back to the two-way street. They want their athletes to come in and train with the want to and the passion and energy, but as a staff, they're not putting any out themselves. So you got kind of a dead program. Mentor, pillar number three. And this one is to teach. How to, sometimes, this is where you kind of become a friend to people.
This one I probably had to work on the most as a coach because I wanted to always be the hard ass. And this one I think now is my best one. So if you think about this, is being a mentor is 24/7, especially now. When I got into coaching, there was no cell phones, okay? The athletes were over in the dorm or wherever, and there was a landline, okay? And you had interaction with them in the weight room, and you pat them on the back as they go out the door. And you didn't see or hear from them till the next day. You didn't have influence on them till the next day. So I kind of miss those days. Because you came in, you coached, and you got them strong, and you gave them their protein shake on the way out, and see you tomorrow, you know? But now, you have such an opportunity to be a mentor, okay? Chad Wheeler, who's playing for SC, I got to work with him his first couple of years. He's a local kid, I think, from Santa Monica. He's 6 foot, 6 and a half. He's probably going to be a top draft pick for SC, left tackle. You know, high dollar position on the O-line, John would know. He came in, he was 229 pounds. He just had shoulder surgery, so when he played, he was around 240. So he lost weight, he looked skinny, looked like a basketball player. And he came in January, we started working with him. We started working with him mostly on eating, and he loved the weight room, so we didn't have to mentor him in the weight room. He loved to lift. So we just worked on eating habits and always having a peanut butter and jelly in your backpack between classes and all kinds of stuff. Well, 18 months later, the guy was 298. I just saw him a couple weeks ago. I was up there visiting. He was 310, looked great, okay? But that came from the mentoring, okay? Everybody's got a phone on them right now, okay? You could text somebody right now something to lift them up right now. As a mentor, whoever it might be, someone you think and needs something said to them or something they did a couple days ago, you want to tell them how good it was, whatever. You have the chance to mentor all the time, and it's there. This one could be an hour presentation itself on integrity. So integrity is my fourth pillar and my last pillar, okay? And basically, it's whatever your rules and policies are, and you enforce them to demand that they're done. And over to the right here is probably my favorite quote of all time of any coach. And you'll get what you emphasize, okay, but you also get what you tolerate. You'll be good at what you emphasize, but you also will be good at what you tolerate. Mickey's with Ohio State. He used to be at Florida. I heard him say this, I think, in 2007 at a conference. I've wrote it down 90,000 times. I went over that with my staff 90,000 times. To me, that one statement sums up coaching overall. You'll be good at what you emphasize. Think about that. If you emphasize great squatting, great technique, you will get great squatting. If you emphasize starting on time, your program, no matter what, you'll have people that show up and work and start on time. If you emphasize that your shoes must be tied when you do weight training, okay, you will get that. If you, as a coach, say you're a football coach and you emphasize, hey, we got great plays for the red zone because we need to score when we get in the red zone, you'll have a good red zone offense because you've worked on the red zone, okay? But the other side, you get what you tolerate, okay? If you tolerate people to be late, they'll be late. If you tolerate people to do half-ass squats, you'll get half-ass squats. If you tolerate them coming in with their shoes untied, they'll come in with their shoes untied. This is basic coaching. You got to decide what your rules, policies are, okay? Because what mine are might be different from yours, okay? As a coach, for whatever it was, okay, we would teach incoming newcomers, we come in and teach them exactly how we want to do it. Teach them exactly how we want to squat, from hand placement to foot placement, to cues, okay, as again, a united staff. We would teach them what being on time was in our program. We would teach them how we start. We would teach them that when we start, and here's the thing, your shoes are tied, boom, ready to go. Well, once we've taught them that, when they walk in the door, then it's our job again to demand or enforce those things for the next 3, 4, 5 years with that player. If we do that, the integrity of our program grows, gets better, better. If we don't do those things, if it's year three, he's a starter, he doesn't need to squat as deep, we turn our head when he squats because he's a big time player, we don't want to hurt his feelings, we don't want to stir up some shit today, he's a little late, he's only 30 seconds late, let him in, don't do that, just turn your head, don't say nothing about it. Oh, his shoes untied. Hey, man, tie your shoes. You know who was supposed to have your shoes tied. Oh, my bad, coach. And you just keep tolerating that. The integrity of your program is going down, 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 down. Okay? And then those younger athletes that you just told 2 weeks ago how you do things, they're looking and they're like, this is bullshit. They don't do this. Look at this guy. He's a junior. They're not doing it with the junior. This is bullshit. The integrity of your program is just going down, down, down. Okay? So this pillar is in your face 24/7. This pillar, this part of coaching is all over you all the time to address this part. If you don't, it's daily housekeeping. If you don't take out the trash, pick up your shit every day, okay, this one will run you in the ditch. Integrity of your program.
For example, when we started a program, we popped a whistle, we clapped our hands. That's how we started our program. Everybody get your hands free. This is how we started our program. This is how we taught the freshmen, and this is how we did it. We'd be like, ready? We'd be 5:58. We'd be like, 3, 1 minute, 10 seconds, 5 seconds, 4, 3, 2, 1. Whistle! Taught them. That's how we started. Year one, day 6. Year two, day 29. Year 5, day 2. That's how we started our strength training. Every time. It didn't change. That was the integrity of our program. We didn't come in one day as a staff and go, hey, let's not clap it up today. I ain't into it. You know, players, I think, are tired of clapping. You know, we that's how we started. And we worked off a clock that was in the weight room that led no doubt. The player couldn't say, well, my watch said, and I always used to say, well, I love when they say, this is my favorite. Well, the locker room clock said, and I'd say, well, next time we start lifting weights in the locker room, then you're right. We lift weights in here, we go off this clock. So that's the integrity of your program. This one's huge. This one, I didn't have to learn. This one, I had to manage. This one is all over you all the time. This is just some coaching things. Again, this is some stuff I write. I kind of went over this in the beginning. Don't show me your fancy Excel sheet. That's simply your plan, okay? Show me technique. Show me effort. Show me execution. Passion for your athletes, because that's your program. Working for Sornex, and something I love to do is I get to go travel and I get to go visit and I get to go see these other schools train, and it's awesome. And it's so funny because when they go back, hey, they know my background. They know I was a strength coach. So the first thing they do is they come hand me this template. And they're like, here's what we got today, coach. Check it out. What do you think? And I look at it, I'm like, oh, that's good. You know, I start watching them work. And sometimes you see template, you see program on a really good page, and you see something done really well. And a lot of times you see great template, but you see different program. You see, you know, front squat, and then you're seeing, well, I don't think they front squat really well. Or whatever it might be, you just see differences. So again, I watch your program. I love when they take me around and they want to show me, hey, this guy, check him out on cleans.
He cleaned 150 last week for a single. He's one of our best cleaners. But while he's showing me that, I'm showing this guy over here ain't doing his shit. While you're showing me your best clean, your other guy over here is skipping squats. Okay, there's your program. It ain't your clean guy. Your program's over there. Okay? I used to say this to my athletes, and I love this one. Do you lift like you're on salary or you're on commission? So I took this more as a strength staff, and I used to challenge my staff. Are you going to coach today like you're on a salary or you're on commission? And he used to fire them up, you know. And I used to actually tell them to bring a calculator in to the office before we'd start the group. How much you make a year? And, you know, that's between you and you. Okay, divide it up by day. Okay, how much do you make a day? And they'd, okay, keep that number in your head. Okay, we have two groups today. Divide that number into two groups. Okay, each group's 90 minutes. So you're gonna make that daily money in those two 90 minutes. The rest of the day, I don't care what you do. Checking your email ain't paying you to do that. Okay, whatever, you go up there and get a coffee, they ain't paying you to do that. Okay, we're paying you to coach your ass off for these two groups. So I want you to go coach as if you're gonna go earn that money in these two 90 minute sessions. The rest of the day, I know you're here, I don't care. Okay, put all you got in those athletes. And the last one, we talked earlier, one thing leads to another, okay? Things like barbell warm-ups, okay? Your barbell warm-up maybe before you do your Olympic lift. Those things matter. I see so many coaches, they come in from a warm-up, the athletes are sweating, they're like, hit your barbell warm-up. While they're doing the barbell warm-up, the coaches are over here like lollygagging, shooting shit, you know, checking their cell phone, all right, getting a coffee refill, and then the guys are over there piss pouring through their barbell warm-up. And then next thing you know, they go to cleans, and the first set looks like shit because the barbell warm-up set them up like shit. And then the second set, they're coaching it. It starts looking a little better. Third set started to get on point. By the fourth one, they're nailing it again. Well, you just wasted three sets because you didn't set the tone in your barbell warm-up. So, again, one thing leads to another. Go coach those little things. The barbell warm-up, the pattern, okay? Because if they go through it, like, you know, like I said, half-assed, it's going to take them eventually before they get back in line again. Evaluating staff. I got some really good stories about how we worked with interns. And as people know, there's some of you might be an intern now. Nowadays, it's very common, especially in the strength conditioning field, collegiate level. There's a lot of people that pay their own way. They go volunteer for the experience, put the resume, hopefully get a job in the future. They sleep on people's couches. Some people sleep in cars. They live off supplements and peanuts and bagels all day from the school because they don't have any money to eat. They want to be a strength coach, so they become an intern. Well, we always used to screen interns and stuff. I wasn't a big intern, like, let's bring in a dozen people, that way we don't have to do anything. They do all the work for us. It wasn't for that. I didn't like a lot of interns because I was scared that my unified message I talked about would start getting watered down. If I had a core group of five coaches that work with this football program, I want us five to be on our stuff. If we allow some other people in, there's a chance it could get watered down. So, We brought in one or two interns per semester, and I always screened them. And how I screened them first was I would invite them to come squat with me when they came for their interview. So we would go out, and they would be gung-ho ready to squat, and they'd say, Coach, what are we going to do? I'm like, oh, we're going to do a set of 10. You know, what's your max? And then I started seeing, like, you know, can they tell the truth? You know, things like that. What's your max? Okay, 400. Okay, first set for you is 200. Okay, oh, well, so that's 50%. Yeah, 50%. 10 reps, right, Coach? Yep. What's next? All right, add a 5. What's next? Add a 5. You keep doing 10. I'd take them through 10 sets of 10 back squats. Put them on a clock, 3 minutes between sets. And I wanted to see how they acted when the bullets started flying. Those 10 sets of 10, whether you're ready for it or not, is a hard workout. It's hard. And I used to do it for myself because I wanted to kick my own ass, but I also wanted to screen somebody, and I wanted to see how they handled stress. Did they squirm? Did they wiggle? Did they stand tall and stay in there and battle with me? So I would work off my 50% of my max. We'd work off two racks. We'd go back and forth. We'd stand behind. We'd spot. We'd count reps. So first of all, I wanted to see if they told me the truth about their max, because if they just exaggerated it, it's going to get on them really quick. Okay. And that was really cool to see. You know, most people get around set five or six, and all of a sudden, you know, I'm having to tow them out of the bottom, you know, like a tow truck, to get them through to get 10 reps. Or I want to see if they were just going to quit. Or I want to see if their technique started changing because it got hard. Okay? I want to start, I'm evaluating these people. Because if they're going to work with these athletes at a place like Ole Miss, USC, okay, how can you go out there and coach toughness and grit and all those things if you ain't got it yourself? It's tough. So again, that's walking the walk. So again, we screened a lot of guys, and hey, I don't know if you're cut out, you know. Or what I love to see was, coach, I wasn't really ready for that. Tell you what, I'll come back tomorrow and I'll get that. Okay, come back tomorrow, maybe a little different mindset, a little what to do, and they come in, they perform. Okay, that's how we screened them. This is how I screened them on the way out. And this is as simple as it gets. The day they're gone, if everybody's asking where they're at, I know they're a hell of an intern. Easy. But if there's days and days and days and a couple weeks gone by, and all of a sudden they're like, hey, coach, what was that guy's name that was here helping? What was it, Johnny? Where's he been? Dude sucked. You made no impact on these athletes. You didn't coach very well. You weren't a good mentor. You didn't make a difference very well. Okay? So that was my deal. It was like, hey, what am I going to check? So when I bring them in after I'd squat them, and I felt they made the cut, I'd give them this next. Here's how I'm going to evaluate you 9 to 10 weeks from now. I'm either going to check which box. And I'd give them a heads up. I'm going to check one box on you, all right, and that's it. And they're just like, whoa. Next thing you know, we had good interns, because they knew that was their resume with me, with our program. Did they make a difference? So when you put it all together, okay, those four pillars should stand. They should hold your mission. Remember, you claimed your victory. You got to claim your victory. Okay? Again, your victory, my victory is different. Okay? No matter where you are, your victory and mine is going to be different. Again, all I wanted was a united strength staff, and I wanted to develop winners. That was my victory. I felt those were things I could control. I felt if I am strong in these four areas and my staff, and we're united, we can get these things done. Okay? I didn't learn this stuff, or I didn't even care about this stuff until after I got fired. Again, go back to those rings. I came out of the barrel hot. All I thought, well, coach, why don't we squat 4 days a week, coach? Show you my ring. We won. You know, that only took me so far. I had to go find ways to coach, ways to motivate, ways to have my players to have faith in me, display passion. Feel I become a mentor. Learn about integrity, how it's in your face nonstop. These can get out of balance, okay? And you're probably gonna identify right now, like, dude, I'm pretty good at this one. Ooh, I suck at this one, okay? I felt as a young coach, I had a shitload of passion. I did not know at all how to mentor, and I wasn't ready to take on integrity yet as a young coach, and I didn't understand the faith part yet. I was blazing with passion, killing it. And then through these trials and tribulations, I had to start getting better in these four areas. I think now, you know, again, the one I probably was worst at was mentor. I think I'm now, that's in my best as a person of influence, a person of coaching.
I told John and those guys I'd flip the script a little bit and talk a little bit about speed on top of philosophy. And I've spoke many times on this presentation, but I kind of summed it all up in one slide. I feel building a speed program is just like building a house. And where you need to spend a bulk of your time and the bulk of your influence really follows this pyramid. So I'll let you kind of gaze at it just for a second before I start talking about it. But you can see the bottom part, foundation and strength, takes up a huge part of this triangle. And if you think about a speed program and building a house, when you think about foundation, think about things. That's when digging goes on. That's when footers are getting poured, leveling, concrete, blocks, brick, and frame, okay? That's the hard work. That's not fun. There's nothing finesse about it. It's hard work. You don't see the person that's going to put curtains or blinds in this house around during that time. They don't want nothing about it. They don't want nothing to do with digging, pouring concrete, laying blocks. Hard work. Your strength program for speed, straining, sore backs, sore legs, squatting, deadlifts, pressing, pulling. Okay? The things that are hard, okay, of a speed program. Many athletes don't like this part of it. They want to go out and do a speed ladder drill or dance around a cone and think they're getting faster. Okay? Because they want to avoid the hard work, the straining, the soreness. Okay? So a bulk of your speed program needs to be devoted toward getting strong. I promise you. You'll go so much farther and higher with this. Next phase, okay, power and function. If you think about a house, someone's got to kind of come in and wire it, plumb it, put the heat and the hair into it. Okay, again, hard work, tedious work. Well, there's where your program, you're going to spend a lot of time also, force application, triple extension movements, clean snatches, jerks, piles, med balls. Now you're taking this strength and making some function out of it, building some power with it, doing some athletic things. Again, two areas that the person that makes it all pretty at the end, they're nowhere around during this time. And then your last part, for the house, I call this finishings, okay? What color are the walls? How the curtains are? The cabinets, the crown molding, okay? The faucet handles, the cabinet handles, the cabinet stain, all those things, the finishings. And that's where I think your drills come in for speed. I think they're important, but I think there's a certain amount of time to be spent on them. And it should not be more than your strength work. Because I've seen a lot of programs with it kind of flipped upside down. A couple sets of squats, let's get out and do our drills. And we're going to get faster. You will. If you just do finishing drills alone, you will get faster because you've learned to run more efficient. Okay? Teaching speed, I'm going to keep it as simple as possible. Your drills, or your, we used to call them speed improvement drills, is just like you're my buddy, you're my pal, you're my friend. PAL, posture, arm action, leg action. Keep it simple. To run fast, if you improve your posture from your head down through your ankle, your angles, you'll become faster, okay? If you improve the efficiency of your arm action and run with a more powerful arm action, you'll become faster, okay? If you improve leg action, meaning how you punch your knee, the shin angle, toe up positions, if you improve those things alone, you will become faster. But I promise you that your ceiling is only so high for those things that take you. So improving those things, you got a ceiling, but it ain't much higher than your head. The ceiling to get strong and the ceiling to get powerful is way higher than this ceiling. And it'll take you that many more places. How I know this is by working with track coaches. When I was strength coaching,
the sprint coach would come in after the sprint training, and he would watch his guys power clean, snatch, back squat, front squat, glute ham raise. And as soon as they're done with those things, he's out the door. They still had bench press, they still had one arm rows, they might have had whatever, some other little stuff. But he would come in and he would watch them clean, snatch, squat, front squat, glute ham raise, out the door. And he knew he had a strength staff that was gonna coach that whether he was in there or not. But he used to always tell us, he's like, these guys are so wired and tuned well, my sprinters and my jumpers. He said, I can only improve so many little things out there on the track. He said, but if I see that their strength levels and their power output levels are getting better, he goes, it's gonna make me look like a great sprint coach. He said, so that's why this part's so important. And if you think, how many of you heard of Justin Gatlin, just ran in the Olympics? I watched him come in the weight room as a skinny little freshman. I had no idea who he was. I knew he was Justin Gatlin because he was on my roster. He's weight training, and he started. Well, he did a fall with us. I went to USC in January. Well, that next spring, he's winning 100 meter, all this stuff. And I'm thinking, the skinny freshman that walked in the door a few months ago and I just met, he's a national champion already? This is crazy. And now, you know, he's running, you know, 9.6, 9.7, whatever it is. But, you know, he had to, Vince, who was his coach, used to say, Justin came in, he knew how to run. Out of high school, we recruited him, he knew how to run. He goes, I knew my best bet to make me look like a good sprint coach is get him in there with you guys in the weight room. So that was a big part of it. So again, the speed part is fun. There's great drills you can do. There's wall drills, you know, prowler pushes, marches, you know, seated arm action drills. You know, all kinds of things you can do. A skip, B skip, all those things, acceleration patterns. Okay, they're great, but just make sure that you understand that this other part is huge. It's a big part of it. It's Big Ed in the back. The process, as I learned this from Ed. The process as a coach and as people that love lifting weights is you get to meet great people. And this was back in May at Summer Strong. I met Ed, and we hit it off a little time before I joined Sornex. I had probably 4,000 to 5,000 calories at a barbecue place, and he probably had 8,000 calories that day. He had like 4 plates, and I had 2. But we talked about throwing, we talked about lifting, and we talked about training. We found real quick that our favorite movement was the dumbbell pullover for our back. We started talking about dumbbell pullover, and then we started talking about front squats, and we started talking about cleans. And we just started having a relationship through the iron. Next thing you know, we got each other's phone number, and then we call. And so getting to meet people like Ed, and yesterday he came up and he trained with me, and I don't know if you follow any of our stuff on Instagram, but we had a ball. I mean, we're doing trap bar dads, we're doing bench press, we're in our tank tops, having a great time, and this is what it's about. And this is what keeps me just, again, I got as much passion as I did when I was 15 when I touched my first barbell right now. You know, I trained yesterday, had a great time, can't wait to go train again Monday, whatever it is. But this is the process. This is where this process takes you. I haven't coached collegially in 3 years, but I've been coaching the whole time. I've not stopped. I'm coaching in different ways. I've got the same passion. Again, now I feel like I'm mentoring more people. For it to really come a full circle is paying it forward is a constant continuum. And if you think about the word continuum, I looked at it also, continuous, extent, series, or whole. Think about this. One day you were the student. Okay, one day you were the student. Now many of you are the teachers. Okay, your students that you're teaching will one day become the teacher. So what are you teaching them now? Think about this. 2 weeks from now, I'm going on down to visit a coach and his staff that was my mentor, and I get to go mentor his staff and him again. So how it all comes full circle It's crazy how it works. So for someone to call me last week and book a flight for me to come down and spend a day and a half with his staff for a guy that coached me and taught me, I thought, everything pretty much, he wants me to teach his staff this many years later, all right, is a huge honor, and he's starting to see these things. And then the last thing, the pen and paper strength app is something I do. Again, this is my way of mentoring. I do it through Instagram. I write training programs. I write motivational quotes. I write common sense approach to strength training. I make some things funny. I want people to laugh. I think when people make people laugh, people like you. Okay? So it's something I've done, and it's something I really enjoy. But something else was, as a strength coach that's went through some hard times, losing jobs, possibly about to be out of money, one thing I did is when I started this, we developed a t-shirt about 6 months ago in June, I think, and we actually sell it through StoreNext, but anyway, instead of like developing the shirt and making some side money and stuff, I created a strength coaches fund for strength coaches who lose jobs, who go through maybe a family emergency, or maybe who go through like things that are happening in Tennessee right now with the fires, or who went through the hurricane that just hit a couple months ago. So I created the sales off the shirt for strength coaches in need. And here's the thing that I'm learning real quick. Strength coaches are so prideful, they won't take it. And I'm calling around, like, hey, I heard your kid. Heard your son had cancer. Heard he was 1 year old. Why don't you let us help? We've sold a shitload of shirts. We got some money. Why don't you let us help? Let us help maybe with a medical bill. No. We've already got that taken care of. Okay, let me buy you dinner, pay for the babysitter, and you go out with your wife and just have a night. No. Can't do that, coach. Can't do it. So this was created, and again, the coaching turnover just started again this year. So I'm, again, hoping to find some people that I can help. Because I've been there, and it sucks when you're looking at the time and you're going, I got one paycheck left. I've got a family. I don't know what's next. And you got family looking to you to provide, and you know you want to be a coach, but right now there ain't a job. And you know probably when there is a job, you're going to move 2,000 miles, 1,000 miles, 500 miles away from your family, whoever, your help. So I created this for that. And it's something, again, we talked about the mentor pillar. These are the things that I'm trying to do now in my role, is I'm trying to educate. I'm trying to help others. If I can help a young strength coach, given my experience as a strength coach, and set something up to what he can expect, I've done my job. I don't think I had that person telling me those things as a young strength coach yet. Or maybe they were, maybe I wasn't ready to hear it. Remember, I was in the middle of getting rings. I didn't want to hear that stuff. That stuff doesn't exist. I'll always have a job. I'll always get the next job. I just go in and bring my rings. Okay, I had to learn. I had to get knocked down a couple times and learn from it. So that's it.
All right, guys, we're gonna have like 10-15 minute break. So washroom, everything like that. We'll get the table set up. We'll get into our Q&A just like we did yesterday. Thanks, AA.
Yep. Thank you.